Okay.
Hi, David. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Okay.
I don't see you.
You cannot see me? Huh?
No.
Okay, in a second. Are we ready? Okay, David, can you see the theater, the hall, and can you see me? Or it's not really.
Okay. I see a hall.
Okay.
Okay,
there you are. Okay, great. Okay, so we can get started now. Okay, maybe let's wait a minute if people are still coming in. Good. Okay. So I think we can start. It's a great pleasure and honor for me to welcome Professor David Gross to today's colloquium. Good afternoon, everybody. And thank you very much, David. David was supposed to be here. In fact, he came all the way to London, but he had to turn back to Santa Barbara for some family emergency. But I really appreciate that you're up and awake at 5 o'clock in the morning at California time for this colloquium. So thank you very much. It's really a wonderful opportunity for ICTP to have this colloquium on what I would say is a historic 50 years of a historic discovery and the theory of strong interactions. In fact, three years ago, we had a very nice colloquium by Weinberg on the electroweak interactions, the theory of electromagnetic and weak interactions, for which he shared the Nobel Prize together with ICTP founding director Salam. And today's talk is about the strong interactions. And that, it's quite amazing that between the two, it pretty much covers the everything that we know about the microscopic world, and that this knowledge is only 50 years old in the history of humankind. So David, of course, has a very distinguished career. In 2004, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics, together with Frank Wilczek and David Politzer, for the discovery of asymptotic freedom in the theory of strong interactions, which really completely changed our perspective about strong interactions, because it showed that the strong interactions are really asymptotically or at very high energies become weak and weak, and you could actually understand them. And after this very major and difficult problem, David turned his attention to easier problems like unifications of all interactions, including gravity. So they wrote a famous paper in 1986 on the heterotic string, which together with Gross, Harvey, Martinek, Rome, which came to be known as the Princeton String Quartet, which unified all these three interactions that I talked about together with gravity. And it's a strange twist of fate, I would say, that the recent developments, string theory really exploded in unimaginable directions. And by a strange twist of fate, the theory of strong interactions is in fact in some ways connected to theory of gravity, which perhaps David will talk about. This is known as holography. So this is, of course, he has many other contributions to physics, but I think these two should suffice. I should add that David was also a very inspiring teacher, and he led a great school in theoretical high energy physics in Princeton for many years. He counts a Nobel laureate and a Fields Medal among his former graduate students. I had the good fortune of taking a quantum field theory course from him, really learned quantum field theory from the horse's mouth, so to speak. But I particularly remember a course that he taught on selected topics in theoretical high energy physics. I don't know if David remembers this, but this is how it went. It was taught in a very David Grosz style. All the senior graduate students received a note in their mailbox saying that you have registered for this course on selected topics in high energy physics. And it was really one of the most wonderful courses I've taken. He really, a panorama of the theoretical high energy physics. Every week he would lecture and the student would lecture. And in 15 weeks we covered basically many, all the advanced topics in physics. But what this showed was really that David really cared about students. He felt that all these Princeton graduate students didn't know enough physics, and he wanted to correct this situation. And this concern and engagement really he carries on a bigger stage. He has really been a senior statesman for theoretical high energy physics or even science on the global stage. I know that he takes it very seriously. I've seen him in action in India, and in recently we were together in the UAE, and he was trying to persuade the president and the policymakers to invest in basic science. So, and this, I want to add that with ICTP, he has really been very keenly engaged. He really gave a lot of time to ICTP. He has been, even from strategic matters to really nitty-gritty of how to implement some strategic ideas. He's on our advisory board, on our scientific council. And so I want to take this opportunity, David, to thank you for this, your engagement with ICTP. So I'm sorry this introduction is a bit long, but it's because the list of his accomplishments is a bit long. But I will try to summarize it in one line. If you look at my T-shirt, basically his talk is about this term in the Lagrange, in the low-energy Lagrangian. If you include the quarks, you have to include this term in the fundamental Lagrangian. And as I was saying, it somehow is related to, this is the Dirac action, this is the Yang-Mills action, and it's somehow related to the Einstein-Hilbert term in the Lagrangian. So I think this is a good summary. So he told me that he might go over time for maybe an hour and 20 minutes, but I gladly agreed. I really think this is a very important chapter in the history of theoretical physics. And I would love to hear more from him. If it goes over time, it's fine. But if some of you have some other engagements, please feel free to, you can leave quietly around 4 o'clock. And the session will be moderated by Professor Giovanni Villadoro, my colleague. So it's over to you, David.
Okay, can you hear me? Can you hear me well?
Yes, loud and clear.
Loud and clear, okay. Well, thank you, Atish. I really am very sorry that I wasn't able to be there in ICTP in person, but this, I guess, is second best. This year, actually, almost precisely, is 50 years of what became known as QCD, the theory of the strong nuclear force. Our paper was arrived at Physical Review Letters exactly 1 year and 3 weeks ago. So, still astonishes me. This is the well-defined 50th anniversary of QCD. And 50 years, Atish said that's a short time, perhaps in human history, but for a human, seems like an awfully long time. In 1973, was roughly the 50th anniversary of quantum mechanics, which was born around that time 50 years ago. And I must say, at that time in my life, quantum mechanics seemed to be, have emerged years and years ago, way, way in the past. I would imagine that if I look at this audience, most of you, probably at least half of the audience, was not alive in 1973. And you might think that that is ancient history, and you probably don't know that much about the actual history. So part of my talk is going to be describing how QCD emerged 50 years ago, and I'll also discuss how QCD looks today, what we've learned, and then along the lines that Atish hinted at, the view towards the future. So let me start at, historically at the beginning, which is not 1973 nor 1923, but really 1911. So that's now 60 years ago. Sorry, that's 110 years ago, when Ernst Rutherford discovered the nucleus of atoms. Not only did he discover the proton, the nucleus, he invented experimental high energy physics. He invented the techniques that we still use today, namely, in order to probe the high energy behavior of nuclei, in order to probe atoms and then nuclei at ever shorter distances, we smash particles together and measure the cross sections of the scattering. We see what comes out. We try to deduce what happened inside the atom, inside the nucleus. This was really the first time that was done, and that is the method we continue to pursue today. What Rutherford did precisely was use alpha particles, which he had discovered and used, emitted in radioactive decays, created a collimated beam of alpha particles, and he aimed them at a gold foil with the idea of deducing what the gold atoms actually contained within them by measuring the deflection of the alpha particles from the gold nuclei, gold atoms. His detector was rather primitive. It was a fluorescent screen. The particles that scattered created points of light on the screen. And his undergraduate student and postdoc sat in a darkened room and measured the position and the angle of deflection of these particles, the alpha particles. And remarkably, they observed that although most of the particles were scattered just a little bit, went off in the forward direction, some of them came back right at you. Rutherford was astonished by this. Previously, it was thought that the atom was some kind of diffuse object containing protons and who knew what else. But it seemed that the only way he could explain these cross sections, which he measured using electromagnetism, classical electromagnetism, was that if all of the positive charge in the atom and most of its mass were located in a very, very small region at the center of the atom. So he discovered the nucleus of atoms. He couldn't measure the radius, but he could bound it from above at roughly one part in 100,000th of the radius of the atom. So he discovered the nucleus of atoms, which, as you know, gave rise to a kind of planetary model of the atom made sensible by Bohr just 2 years later with the Bohr atom, which really was the crucial impetus over the next 10 years to developing the quantum theory of the atom and then quantum mechanics. The atom, the nucleus of the atom was very hard to study. It required much better microscopes. It took 20 years for Chadwick to discover the neutron. So neutrons and protons were present within the nucleus. And the study of the nucleus and of the nuclear force then became one of the main focuses of high energy physics, of particle physics for the next century, using essentially Rutherford's technique, smash particles together. This is the modern version of LHC with a detector which is slightly more complicated than his detector. And the energies, of course, now the TV range, and we scatter protons off protons, not fixed targets. But, you know, Rutherford invented this technique, and we haven't done better in 112 years. We still don't have better ways or other ways of studying matter at very, very short distances, except by smashing particles into particles. When I started graduate school, there had already been after World War II, very high energy, GV energies, accelerators being built. And Berkeley, where I was a student, was the CERN of its day. It had the highest energy proton, fixed target proton accelerator. And it was very exciting because lots of new particles and new patterns were being discovered weekly. But the strong force, by then it was known that there really must be two forces acting within the nucleus. The weak force responsible for radioactivity, but the strong force was the force responsible for holding the nuclei together and for whatever went on inside the nuclei and for creating perhaps all these new particles which were being discovered, but it was especially intractable. It wasn't at all clear which particles were elementary. What were the basic constituents of nuclear matter? The proton and the neutron, of course, but then dozens of new particles were being discovered, starting with a pion of Yukawa, but then heavier particles like the proton, like the neutron, but with different quantum numbers. They all seemed rather similar. Which are the elementary particles from which we might construct all the other ones? Which are the basic constituents of matter? And then what are the dynamics? What principles determine the dynamics? You know, how can you write down a theory of the forces among these particles? And then even if you could write down a theory, and people tried from the time of Yukawa onward, it was clear and measurable that the couplings, the strength of the forces between these particles was very strong. So how could you calculate? Because you couldn't just do perturbation theory like you could in electrodynamics. Dyson, who had contributed so much to the understanding of quantum electrodynamics, tried very hard, along with others, but then gave up after a few years and famously said in 1960 that the correct theory of the nuclear force will not be found in the next 100 years. That's what he said in 1960. It only took about 13 years. And the general feeling, I must say, at that time was that some new revolution, like quantum mechanics, something new was required because one had no idea how to explain these forces. And in retrospect, it's kind of clear what the problem was. The problem really was that the sources of the force, which we now know are the colored charges of quarks and gluons, were completely hidden from view. You couldn't see the basic essence of matter. In the case of atomic physics, of course, the electron was quite visible, and you could pull it out of atoms, measure its properties, do all sorts of wonderful things with electrons, the basis of the Industrial Revolution. But quarks and gluons were invisible. Smashing particles together, like smashing atoms together, you would think the basic constituents would be revealed. But in all the experiments, no matter how high the energy was at that time and up to today, quarks, colored particles, never emerged. So the only thing you could see were these new particles like the proton and neutron, which we now know are color neutral. So the charges were completely hidden for quite a while. And then the conceptual tool, the framework of relativistic quantum mechanics, was really not very well understood. Quantum field theory, invented shortly after the birth of quantum mechanics, was plagued with difficulties. And those difficulties were partially understood, at least technically, in the 50s, with the ability to renormalize a theory and get finite results for physical observables. That was extremely successful. We had a small parameter, the fine structure constant, one could calculate, but the basic dynamics of quantum field theory, renormalization, was not understood. And by and large, it was thought to be a trick. And the infinities, the ultraviolet divergences that one encountered were being swept under the rug, but something was unphysical about that and probably suggested that one needed something better than quantum field theory. There were also, quantum field theory was essentially only treatable in perturbation theory. And this was fine for QED, where the coupling is very small, but not for more stronger interactions that were hypothesized. So Atish took my course in quantum mechanics. I took Steve Weinberg's course in quantum mechanics as a graduate student. And in the first lecture, he wrote on the blackboard, field theory, under attack at that time in Berkeley, is essentially Feynman diagrams, perturbation theory. No useful non-perturbative methods were known at that time. And as we know now, many of the main properties of QCD are due to non-perturbative effects, which we still can't completely control, but we have a lot more insight into and many new methods. There was a phenomenological theory of the weak interactions, Fermi's or fermion theory, current-current interactions, and it was moderately successful, as long as you only used it in lowest order, Born approximation, which was all that was required at low energy. But how to make it unitary, how to make it into a complete theory, how to renormalize it, it appeared unrenormalizable, was unknown. Yang-Mills theory, non-abelian gauge theories, the non-abelian generalization of Maxwell's abelian gauge theory, was emerged in the very early 1950s by Yang and Mills, but it was plagued with massless bosons, and which did not exist in nature, were not observed. So what do you do? And people tried immediately almost to construct non-abelian gauge theories of the strong interaction. Again, the question was, what are the charges that couple to the gauge, that source the gauge field? You need some kind of conserved symmetry, some gauged symmetry of nature. And the only symmetries that were being discovered at that time in the case of the strong interaction, in addition to the abelian E and M symmetry, were flavor symmetries, isospin, etc., strangeness. But those were not exact symmetries. And it is inconsistent, as people rapidly became aware of, to construct a gauge theory of broken global symmetries. So theory was in trouble. And in addition, there were philosophical deep reasons why many felt that field theory had to be replaced by something, by another revolution, like quantum mechanics, but different. My mentor, my advisor at Berkeley, was Jeffrey Chu, who led this attack in the United States on quantum field theory. And he introduced two ideas that were very influential. One was nuclear democracy. All the hadrons that one knew, every week or two at Berkeley at that time, a new particle was being discovered. And they're all equally fundamental. You can think of, say, the 3-3 resonance, which was the first resonance state discovered by Fermi in the early 50s at Chicago. Could be thought of as a bound state of nucleons and pions. But you could also think of the pion as a bound state of protons and neutrons, or antineutrons. You could see no real difference, if you ignore the weak interactions, between any hadron. Why consider the proton a neutron and pion as fundamental? Chu said all hadrons are equally fundamental, which is a real difference between Democritus and, right, there are no basic constituents like electrons and nuclei from which you build all composite atoms. And then, since there was no real idea of how to write down a theory of the forces, Chu said, well, let's, and it was so hard, by the way, to construct a relativistic quantum mechanical theory that was soluble or understandable, because the forces are strong, and because of particle production, any relativistic quantum mechanical theory is a many-body theory. The idea was that you use general principles that we believe in and are even more fundamental than quantum field theory itself, like causality and unitarity, which must be satisfied, it would seem, philosophically for any theory. Perhaps if those general principles determine a unique S matrix. So hard to construct the scattering amplitudes that one measures in these scattering amplitude experiments that maybe there's only one answer, and that's the dynamical principle. Now, in Russia, another thing happened that attacked quantum field theory, and that was what is called the problem of zero charge, no force, free theory, or the Landau pole. And that was the conclusion that Landau and his disciples reached by studying the short distance behavior of quantum field theories. Mostly they studied quantum electrodynamics, which was a successful theory of E&M. And in all theories they studied, the physical coupling, the one you actually measure, we call the fine structure constant, vanished no matter how small they made the bare coupling, the coupling that was needed to define the theory, as you removed the ultraviolet cutoff that you needed to introduce in order to make sense out of the theory to begin with. This conclusion was based largely on summing a subclass of perturbation theory diagrams, down Feynman diagrams. But the conclusion they reached was that if you really tried to go to arbitrarily high energies, remove the ultraviolet cutoff, that you couldn't end up with a finite coupling like the fine structure constant. In fact, it would have to vanish. Otherwise, you would get singularities, poles, and amplitudes that violated causality. And Landau concluded, what is the origin of this problem from a physical point of view? Well, this is really a manifestation of screening, of the fact that in a dielectric medium, electric charges are screened. Now, the vacuum is a dielectric medium in quantum electrodynamics, because the vacuum is not full of, is empty, of course, but not, as we know, can appear to be full of virtual electron-positron pairs, which can pop in and out of the vacuum in very short time. So we must think of the vacuum as a medium which contains dipoles, electron-positron pairs, and those orient themselves in, when you put in an external charge, to screen the charge that you insert into the vacuum. There's a dielectric medium screens the charge, and that leads to the fact that the electric force actually decreases as you at larger and larger distances, because there's more screening, and conversely increases at very short distances where there's less screening. And this is actually true, we know now, for all non-asymptotically free theories. And Landau concluded, we reached the conclusion, again, 1960, sort of the low point of theoretical physics at the time, that within the limits of formal electrodynamics, a point interaction. So if you really go to define the theory with no cutoff in the UV, you introduce a coupling that measures the strength of that force at arbitrarily short distances. No matter how strong you make that coupling, then at physical distances, there's no interaction at all. And so Landau, bold as he was driven to the conclusion that the Hamiltonian method, quantum field theory, for the strong interactions is dead and must be buried, although, of course, with deserved honor. Now, he noted the strong interaction. This problem exists for electrodynamics, which is probably by itself inconsistent at high energies or short distances. But in the case of electrodynamics, we know that that only occurs at extraordinarily high energies, way beyond her measurement at that time or today or far in the future. But in the case of the strong interactions, where the coupling starts out stronger, this was an immediate problem, and that was yet Landau's conclusion. And Landau was very powerful in the Soviet Union and forbade his group, which was by far the best in that time, to work on quantum field theory. And my colleagues, Polyakov, Say, and Migdal, were not allowed to work on quantum field theory. And when they did, they had to disguise this by saying they were working on many-body condensed physics, where you were allowed to use quantum field theory, but that was not a fundamental theory. In any case, that was the atmosphere when I was a graduate student. What about experiment? Well, unlike today, theory was in shambles. Nobody knew what to do. Nobody could calculate anything. Theorists were not very successful by and large, but experimenters were. They just started constructing these wonderful accelerators, and the pace of discovery was amazing. There were great experimental excitement, many new discoveries, new particles, new patterns that were emerging, Reggie theory, flavor symmetries, strangeness, new patterns of particles, and were being discovered all the time. So just sort of the opposite of the situation today, when theory is supreme and experimenters for many years have been largely confirming our fantastic standard model. And then there was a very interesting development, which was experimentally and theoretically important, but didn't get to the heart of the matter. Because many theorists and experimenters believed that the real secret of the strong interaction lay in the high energy behavior of scattering. Well, that makes sense, but only at very low momentum transfer, diffraction scattering. So as you probably know, when you scatter particles, most of them go in the forward direction. And that's what contributes most of the total cross-section. And theorists were very interested in that and discovered regularities, in particular Reggie behavior, which seemed to give a framework for understanding high energy near forward scattering. So one had a situation where most of the data was forward scattering. Theorists were very interested in forward scattering, so they told experimenters, go study forward scattering. Experimenters were happy because there were a lot of data in the forward direction. You get better statistics. And no one particularly was interested in the high momentum transfer scattering events, where the secret of the strong interactions were to be found. They should have realized, okay, how did Rutherford discover the nucleus? Well, what motivated him to hypothesize the nucleus was the very few events where the alpha particles scattered backwards or at very large angles. Not many of them, cross-section is much smaller, but those tell you really about short distance structure of the atom. Until 1968, really. By that time, I was already dissuaded from the bootstrap philosophy, and I was a postdoc at Harvard and beginning to study some rules. People were very interested in electromagnetic and other currents that coupled to electromagnetism or to the currents that appeared in Fermi's weak interaction theory. And those were physical, because you could measure them in electron hadron scattering or neutrino hadron scattering. So those were okay. And the common game among some of us were to use very simple, illegitimate, perturbative free field techniques or models like the Sugawara model, where you could try to analyze the product, the short distance product, of these physically measurable currents. And for example, Callan and I derived a sum rule that could be experimentally tested in the scattering amplitudes of electrons off protons. For the cross sections, that F2 is one of the structure functions in the cross section of electron proton scattering. And Bjorkane noticed this thumb rule, well, suggests that n dimensional reasoning suggests that these cross sections should scale, that there's no scale in them. And we use other even less meaningful techniques or allowable techniques, just free field theory, to derive some very specific relations, some rules, abstracted from the quark model. By that time, quarks had been discovered, had been suggested by Gell-Mann and Zweig as as a way of mathematically summarizing the flavor symmetries of hadrons. And of course, we're fractionally charged, which was really weird because nobody had ever seen fractionally charged particles. But we showed that if you just assume that these currents had a short distance expansion, we would operate our product short distance behavior. If you just take from the quark model to say that the currents are made out of quarks, quarks carry the charge inside hadrons, but otherwise there's no force, free field theory, and they're spin 1/2. Quarks have spin 1/2 fermions. Then the longitudinal cross sections vanish at very high energies, whereas if there would be spin 1 or spin 0 charged constituents, it would be the opposite. The transverse cross section would vanish. So there were these vague ideas, mostly abstracted from perturbation theory or even free field theory. And the remarkable phenomena happened that as soon as the slack, deep, inelastic scattering accelerator, so this was very high energy electrons scattering off photons, fixed target. The scaling of the cross sections and some of these thumb rules appeared to be roughly correct. That was an enormous surprise because people expected, just as Rutherford expected, that the cross sections would fall off very rapidly at large angles. Nobody really wanted to do this experiment, by the way. This was not where slack, the community imagined that new discoveries would be made at this new machine. But Friedman, Kendall, and Taylor boldly went ahead, and they discovered that the proton looked like it was made out of freely moving quarks. They won the Nobel Prize for the discovery of quarks. So if you assume that inside the proton there were freely moving quarks carrying the electric charge inside the proton, then you treated them as freely moving particles, you in fact had scaling if the quark masses were very small, as we now know they are. And the quark model sum rules, like spin sum rule, worked. Now, the data was very crude. It was very low energy by today's standards, and the errors were big. But this behavior sort of stood out. It was easy to understand if you just said you had free quarks moving around inside the proton. As far as I was concerned, this was an amazing discovery, but incredibly confusing. The experiments and the sum rules convinced me that it looked like hadrons were indeed made out of point-like constituents. And two, the charged constituents, the electrons and neutrinos coupled to, were quark. Quarks are real. They're not just mathematical devices to construct representations of flavor symmetries, but actually the charges, the representations that the basic constituents were made out of. But on the other hand, the quarks never came out, were never produced at slack or anywhere else, so they must interact very strongly to create composite color singlet states, or to create composite states with integer charges, electric charges. So how could one explain scaling? And it was clear that in quantum field theory, that once scaling, this idea of no scale physics at very high energies emerged, people started studying how, is scaling a feature of quantum field theory if you have a theory without a scale. Classically, like electrodynamics, if you make the electron mass zero, is that really a property of quantum field theory? No, it's not. Quantum effects destroy naive scale invariants. They also completely muck up the sum rules that were being tested at slack. So that confusion, but in addition, the discovery of it, obsessed me for the next 5 years. I, of course, had a detour into string theory, which developed at the same time. String theory is even older than QCD, and it was supposed to be a theory of the strong interactions without a Hamiltonian, without basic constituents, originally without strings, just a bootstrap approach. But then it became rapidly clear that strings were very soft. The large momentum transfers, scattering fell off exponentially. Certainly not like what one thought slack. So string theory could not explain scaling. So by 1972, I had a plan, a program. I was going to kill quantum field theory forever. The idea was I would take the experiments, the slack experiments, seriously. Not everybody did, because nobody could explain them. And it was quite reasonable to say, I don't believe the experiments. Experiments were very low energy. At that time, we called it precocious scaling. And the errors were big. It always happens, by the way, in physics, or often happens when you make an experimental discovery. The evidence is questionable for quite a while. And so very smart people, like Ken Wilson, who was teaching us so much about non-perturbative quantum field theory, renormalization, et cetera, really believed that in modern terms, the dynamics of the strong interaction would be governed by some kind of fixed point theory, which we would discover. But the idea that it would be governed by free theory at short distances seemed crazy. And he really believed the experiments were going to change. If one went to high enough energies, there would be corrections to the scaling. But I said, let's take the experiment seriously and kill quantum field theory. And the idea was that it seemed that scaling required what we called asymptotic freedom, namely that as one went to arbitrarily short distances, the couplings that control the force, the interaction, vanished. Which we now call asymptotic freedom, and based on an idea, you know, a result of Parisi, Callan, and I showed, also in 1973, for all quantum field theories that made sense, renormalizable quantum field theories with time, if you took the experiment seriously, you had really scaling, naive scaling, that for all theories except non-abelian gauge theories, which were, our theorem didn't hold, had to be asymptotically free. So one had to have this theory where the short distance behavior was the opposite of what it was for QED, where the coupling became stronger at QED, the coupling becomes stronger at short distances, asymptotically free theories, it becomes weaker. And then the idea was to show that asymptotically free theories do not exist. And that seemed reasonable, just like Landau assumed that, in effect, charge renormalization is vacuum polarization, is screening, and the charges, the coupling, the force should go to zero this is a typo, which I can't correct online, but G should go to infinity, not zero, at short distance. That was the Landau poll. So that was the idea. Scaling requires asymptotic freedom. Asymptotic free theories don't exist. And then, okay, quantum field theory cannot explain the experiment. And indeed, Coleman and I proved, same year, 1973, around the same time, that no sensible field theory with any number of scalar particles or spin 1/2 particles or abelian gauge theories with arbitrary interactions is asymptotically free. That seems like a very strong theorem, but because if the theory is asymptotically free, perturbation theory gets better and better at short distances and therefore is controllable, and therefore you can prove this theorem. Non-abelian gauge theories, again, it's actually, of course, wrong because it is asymptotically, it is asymptotically free. Okay, so that was the goal. And the final portion of this plan was to rule out Yang-Mills theory or non-abelian gauge theory, which had been where the problem of massless gauge bosons had been solved by Higgs, Rout, Englert, and Ed Hooft and Veltman, and was now understood to be a physical renormalizable quantum field theory. And at this point, Frank Wilczek became my first graduate student. I was still a young professor at Princeton. And here is Frank. And we discovered that within non-abelian gauge theories, Yang-Mills theories, they possess the remarkable feature, perhaps unique among renormalizable theories, indeed unique in four dimensions, of asymptotically approaching free field theory. And that will give Bjorkane scaling. We therefore suggest that one look to a non-abelian gauge theory of the strong interactions to provide the explanation for scaling. For me, this was a surprise. Shouldn't have been, but it was, that there actually exists a asymptotically free theory. So if you believe the experiment, this is the theory you need to base the strong interaction on. And the dynamics had to be non-abelian gauge theory, gluons. The gluons had to be electromagnetically neutral. You didn't see them in the experiments. So there had to be charged matter, electrically charged matter, and we already knew the patterns of flavor symmetries suggested that they were fundamental representations of the flavor group, and that they had three colors, three quantum numbers. That was necessary to explain high D by not decay, the total cross-sec annihilation cross-section of electrons, positrons, to hadrons. So there was really no choice as to what the dynamics was. A three triplet to Fermi's, three flavors, that's all that one knew at the time. Now we know there's six, maybe more, but six flavors of quarks. SU3 color gauge group because of color. That's it. Nothing else you could do. Can't introduce scalars or other things because that would have destroyed asymptotic Reno. That's QCD. In our larger paper, we started, so why does QCD not be screen the colored charge? Well, because there's another effect in relativistic quantum mechanics of a gauge theory. And in particular in QCD, in addition to having charged color, charged fermions, quark, there are also colored charged gluons, which are in the adjoint representation of QCD, of quantum chromodynamics. So they carry the color of quark, anti-quark. They're eight such SU3 gluon charges, and they're kind of strong. Their joint representation is bigger, has a bigger Casimir than the fundamental representation. So quarks anti-screen the charges. Gluons also screen the charges, but they, in addition, anti-screen the charges. These permanent magnetic moments in the vacuum exhibit not diamagnetism, but paramagnetism. These are permanent dipoles of a spin one colored gluon. And paramagnetism acts the opposite to diamagnetism. It increases the force at large distances. There's more paramagnetism, decreases the force at short distances. And what we discovered was that if there are enough fermions, if there aren't that many fermions, light fermions, less than 17, 16 and a half, then the QCD force will be asymptotically free. In our bigger version of the letter, we studied these asymptotically free gauge theories and started to calculate the corrections to deep and elastic scattering, because the force vanished at arbitrarily high energies, but before it got there, it varied logarithmically, and so there were measurable logarithmic corrections to the scaling behavior, which one could calculate using perturbation theory. We also tried to understand why the quarks didn't get out. That was the deep mystery. And we said, well, maybe the symmetry is not broken like it was in the emerging theory of the weak interaction. But in asymptotically free theories, that doesn't necessarily mean that you would see quarks and gluons. There might be little connection between the free Lagrangian and the spectrum of states. The infrared behavior of green functions, in this case, is determined by the strong coupling limit of the theory. And it might very well be that this is such so as to suppress all but color singlet states, neutral colored states, and that the colored fields as well as the quarks could be seen in the at large momentum, but never produced as real asymptotic slates. This is what we call now confinement. Now, what's going on? Well, let's take electromagnetism. We have two charged electron positron has a Coulomb force, classically, which we calculate using Gauss's law, right? So we have the positive charge, you draw a sphere around it. Gauss's law tells you that the electric field times the area of the field of the sphere is equal to the charge contained within that sphere. And that's why, of course, the force pulls off like inverse distance squared, that Coulomb's law. And if you calculate the work needed to pull the quarks apart, well, it increases but saturates at the ionization energy. So if you have more energy than I, you can pull electrons out of atoms and make them blow in wires and do work for you. But in the case of the chromodynamic field, the classical result would be the same. But we know that the quantum vacuum is a medium, a complicated medium pictured here due, with the help of lattice gauge theory, full of fluctuating fields, these virtual gluon magnetic dipoles that magnetic moments that anti-screen, and we believe that they squeeze the flux into tubes. And the flux of the chromodynamic electric field. This is sort of familiar in the dual magnetic case in superconductivity, where the magnetic field lines, they produced by monopole pairs, would be squeezed into a vortex or a flux tube of magnetic lines. And that, of course, is seen, the Meissner effect in real superconductors. That analogy was only understood after the fact as well, that such a thing could give a physical picture of confinement. So now the calculation is that you calculate the electric field times the area of the sphere around the charge, but the area is now limited to this fixed area of the flux tube. So the force between the quark anti-quark does not decrease, remains constant as you pull the quarks apart. So you try to pull quark away from an anti-quark and a meson, you have to overcome this constant force at large, at any at large distances. And the work required then increases linearly. And that's confinement. It would take an infinite amount of energy to ionize a meson, at least at zero temperature. And this is a picture of what actually happens in QCD, thanks to lattice gauge theory. And you see the flux lines of the gauge field, which one can deduce from these Monte Carlo simulations, form in a flux tube. And by the way, looks like a fat string. No coincidence, because it does look like a fat string. Now QCD, everything sort of fit together. There was really no choice immediately of what the theory could be. And it explained these experiments. And the acceptance was rather immediate for a small group of people, which I defined as the smart people. But most theorists, I think, did not believe in this. It seemed pretty crazy to base a theory on particles that you could never see as asymptotic states. I had big arguments in Princeton with my senior colleague, Eugene Wigner, who had defined particles as irreducible representations of the Poincaré group that you see as asymptotic states. And the idea that you could base a theory on particles that were confined and that you could never see as asymptotic states like quarks, gluons, made no sense. And then confinement was just a very unsubstantiated conjecture, still has not been proved. But there was slow and steady growth and accepting in QCD over the ensuing years. Partly because one could do things. I mean, what really pushes physics rapidly forward often is the fact that a new idea allows you to calculate. And as you all know, people flock to in the direction of some new development that allows them to address old and even new physical problems easily and generate lots of interesting papers. We started immediately deep elastic scattering because there are corrections to the naive rules. Could be tested, also E plus E minus. The hadrons, their corrections to the naive rules and other things that were old ideas, but now you could calculate. But the most amazing, and then in addition, there were theoretical milestones that made it some of these crazy ideas of confinement and so on less objectionable. In particular, but most importantly, perhaps, was the invention of lattice gauge theory by Wilson, immediately jumping on the problem and saying, okay, let's put it on a computer and calculate the masses. That was, again, very difficult. Took a long time before it became a precise tool, but it gave one a strong coupling, very far away from the continuum limit, picture of what confinement consists of, these stringy picture. André Navarre and I studied a theory which one could solve exactly for large n in two dimensions, but it gave us a precise and analyzable example of dimensional transmutation, which I'll get to. And it solved large N QCD. Now, in two dimensions, confinement is trivial because the force is perturbatively confining. But you could actually solve this theory and very reassuringly have a theory which made sense and was soluble of confined quarks, which didn't ever appear in the asymptotic state. But perhaps the most dramatic thing that happened in the next year or two was an experiment and in the measurement of the electron positron annihilation cross section. And here too, a new accelerator came into play, the E plus E minus storage collider at SLAC. So, you know, if you just were naive, free field theory or QCD, you could calculate the total cross section for electron positrons to annihilate the hadrons. And it was a measurement of the charge, the square of the charge is the fundamental constituents of the proton, of hadron, of the strong interaction. And that was one of the motivations for three colors. So the total cross-section pictured here, once one gets beyond the rho omega mesons, was predicted. If there are three colors and three flavors and fractional charges, and it seemed to work, one of the motivations for scaling for QCD. But at the end, this new machine started seeing more events, and Richter in 1974 at a meeting there in Trieste, which I attended, he announced with great fervor that QCD is dead. Now, it wasn't QCD, he said. The name hadn't been invented at that time. But all these silly ideas of free field theory, behavior, et cetera, were wrong. The cross-section wasn't constant compared to lepton cross-sections, but rising. Now, some of us at that meeting knew very well that charm forks had to be there to make sense of the electroweak interaction and so on. And Applequist and Ponsard actually studied the properties using Q's asymptotic freedom of a charm anti-charm bound state and suggested it be rather narrow, although not as narrow as discovered, and felt that, okay, this is not death of QCD, but rather the indication that one is approaching the charm threshold. But the experimenters didn't have much trust at that point in theory. And theorists were rather timid because they were, you know, hadn't had many successes in the past 60 years. And so, but then Richter went back to Stanford, and in the fall, he and Ting discovered this was a threshold for the emergence of charm particles. And so there are more quarks, more charm meson has 4/3, a big charge, it changes the cross section. And then of course, that does agree with quantum chromodynamics. Not only that, this measurement was extraordinarily informative, not just about the strong interactions and these marvelous charmonium or then bottom hadronic states that could be analyzed perturbatively because of asymptotic freedom. But also later the Z boson, of course. And so that experimental problem that was not a problem and resolved and led to calculable analysis of the charmonium spectra gave an enormous push to the acceptance of QCD. But what about the actual predictions and the tests? Well, this is 1989. This is 16 years later. And this is the measurement of the fine structure constant of QCD, which we know depends on the scale. So this is measured at the energy of the Z meson. Z boson, and theory and experiment seem to agree. But really? I mean, a straight line more or less passes through the data as well. So the test, the QCD, took a lot of time. I mean, the deviations from totally free field theory are only logarithmic in energy. This is the measurement today. This is not the most of asymptotic freedom. This is one of, actually, I just heard that there's a better measurement now at the final atlas. Yeah, well, it is atlas. I've been able, using the sitting at production of Z particles, measuring jet distributions, to measure the fine structure constant now to roughly a half a percent. But this is many, many different experiments, all described by one coupling, which is, as we'll see in QCD, calculable. So this is a an amazing development of experimental high energy physics, but it took a long time. This is the deviations, the end of the Hera deep and elastic machine. You see the deviations from totally straight lines is kind of small, but now quite precise. This is after 30 more years. Today, of course, we have from the LHC incredibly impressive tests. In 99% of the events at the LHC are QCD, if you want to. QCD is really a gluon quark scattering machine. And not only have the experiments gotten more precise, much higher energies, but the theory has gotten much more precise. But what about actually describing the hadrons, the particles we actually see as asymptotic states, the proton, the neutron, and all the others? To understand them, we can't just use perturbation theory. We need to understand this complicated medium, the QCD vacuum. And that, to be precise, the only tool we have so far is lattice QCD. And that still remains the only tool, if you're not going to go in the for the large distance structure of the theory, for precise, controllable, first principle calculation of static hadronic properties. But it's become an extraordinarily precise tool, which is necessary not just for testing QCD, but also testing potential new physics beyond QCD, because you want to understand the background from first principles precisely. And that, over the years, is an enormous effort, has reached a new level of maturity due to, well, computers are billions, trillions of times more powerful than existed 40 years ago, but also a lot of theoretical ingenuity and a lot of hard work. And now we can calculate the spectrum of QCD, again, to about 1% precision, including, you know, a mass difference of neutron proton. The neutron is slightly heavier than the proton, and that's partly because of the fact that the bare quarks have slightly different masses. The quarks have slightly different masses, electromagnetism, and the strong interactions. So that is totally amazing. Hadron masses can be calculated, and other static hadronic properties, form factors. There are also, on the theoretical side, the ability to calculate. So this is the beta function, the crucial thing that enters and determines very high energies, the behavior of the coupling as a asymptotic freedom that we calculated, but this has now been pushed. We've only depicted the next three terms in the beta function. I think it's now up to six terms. Unbelievable calculational developments have occurred. Amplitudes have become a totally remarkable development in the ability to calculate perturbatively in non-abelian gauge theories to high order. What appeared to be absolutely impossible now is standard. And this is, so in addition to the leading order, say, scaling results that we derived 50 years ago, you can now calculate next to leading order and next to next to leading order and next to next to next leading order. And this is because of the discovery of remarkable structure and simplicity of these scattering amplitudes, which a priori seemed beyond human control. And that's going to continue. There seems to be no question that there's much more hidden in perturbation theory than just numbers. There's structure, there's beauty, and power. Okay, I want to just emphasize some aspects of QCD, which I like to call a perfect theory. And what do I mean by that? Well, certainly in the old-fashioned sense of what we might have expected 50 years ago, it is a perfect theory. It has no infinities, really. None of these UV divergences are there, really. It has no adjustable parameters, really. I mean, they're quark masses, but those set them equal. They're not part of QCD. They come from the Higgs mechanism. If they were zero, QCD would have no adjustable parameters. And most importantly, there's in just QCD by itself, there's no new physics at short distances or high energies. It's the first theory which we know is more understandable, simpler at arbitrarily short distances. So let me discuss these points rapidly. But so there are no UV divergences in QCD. And what do I mean by that? Well, look at the answer. We can write down the answer using lattice gauge theory, which of course we have can only do if we introduce a cutoff to define the theory on a lattice. But in QCD, the coupling that we introduce at very short distances doesn't blow up like Landau, it vanishes. So that's not divergent. Infinities only appear if we try to express observable, which are actually measured, of course, at finite distances, in terms of those measured at infinitely small distances, which is just asymptotically approachable, accessible. And then sometimes if you try to express a finite thing in terms of zero, you're going to get infinity. One divided by zero is infinite. So in lattice gauge theory, for example, for many static properties, you can write down a multidimensional integral, which is a solution of QCD. If you have a lattice version of QCD in a finite box, it depends, of course, on the lattice spacing. And the coupling you introduce is the lattice coupling at distances of order of the lattice spacing A, which in the end you want to take to zero and you want to take the box to infinity. And you know how to take the coupling to zero because of asymptotic freedom. And if you do so, you'll find that physics, the proton mass remains finite and is calculable. And you never, in this procedure, doing lattice gauge theory, ever encounter any infinities if the theory works, which it appears to. No proof, not rigorous, but unquestionably true. And infinity never appears. Then no adjustable parameters. So recently I read a wonderful review of quantum electrodynamics that Feynman gave in 1961, the Solvay conference on the status of quantum electrodynamics, which the previous few years had become incredibly successful. And Feynman surveyed that status, but then he asked, is this a complete theory all by itself? Ignore everything else, which he knew existed, just QED. So is it a theory that makes sense at all energies? Is it a theory where we could imagine calculating the fundamental parameters that appear in the theory, the mass of the electron, the bond structure constant? So he knew that the mass of, you know, if the electron mass was started out zero, the bare mass was zero, the mass that appears in Lagrange, there would be a symmetry that protects that axial symmetry. But he already knew at that time the ideas of spontaneous symmetry breaking were around. So he knew you could produce a mass perhaps. And so he asked, what happens if we take pure QED with only zero mass electrons and photons interacting with no other particles, having no cutoff energy? He said, well, you can't produce a mass because the system is invariant to a change of scale. So there's no parameter to define a length. An electron with a mass defines a length, the inverse mass. So I'm not certain. Feynman was always careful, but it appears to me impossible to generate a specific length from no scale whatsoever. So he concluded, okay, I don't see how we could possibly calculate the electron mass. I don't see also how we could calculate the fine structure constant. But he was wrong. Quantum effects invariably break scale invariant, therefore can produce a physical mass, and incidentally, determine the coupling, which varies with scale at that scale. And that's what QCD does. It has no infinities and in effect no adjustable parameters. But you have to ignore the quark masses, which the light quark masses are totally ignorable. And you could regard the number of colors, the number of quarks, as three parameters, which we don't know how to calculate. But now that was way beyond what Feynman were thinking of. And that works by what we call dimensional transmutation, which we already kind of reviewed with lattice gauge theory. We must, to define the theory to begin with, we must introduce an arbitrary scale where we cut the theory off, or if you want to define what we mean by the coupling, that it's measured at that scale. And the famous beta function tells you how that, if you can calculate it, how that coupling varies with the energy you've introduced to define it. But a physical parameter, P there, can't depend on that scale. It's arbitrary. And therefore, the renormalization group tells you how this, any physical parameter depends on this arbitrary scale mu and the coupling, which is defined at that scale. Its total variation vanishes, but that's because of explicit mu dependence, explicit cutoff dependence, or cutoff dependence due to the fact that the coupling depends on the cutoff. Now, if you manage to have a physical observable in the theory, which isn't obvious in a scale invariant theory that such a physical, like a mass, could be produced, then it must have a completely specified dependence because it actually has physical dimensions of mu at mass scale. And therefore, solving this equation, you know how it depends on the coupling. In asymptotically free theories, where the coupling vanishes at small, at large energy, small distance, that means that roughly for weak coupling goes like mu, the mass scale we've introduced, e to the minus 1 over g squared, where g squared is the coupling defined at mu, which is sort of a natural non-perturbative result in quantum mechanics. In non-asymptotically free theories like QED would have the totally bizarre behavior that the physical mass of some kind of dynamically produced mass scale would blow up as G went to zero. Crazy. Such theories probably don't make any sense as complete theories. But if a mass scale is produced, then any physical quantity must not depend on mu, therefore be that physical mass through the dimension, the engineering dimension of the parameter, and C, the constant that multiplies that, you know, can't depend on G, can't depend on anything, must be a calculable number. So in a theory like QCD, all physical parameters, if there are no masses, no quark masses to begin with, are calculable. No adjustable parameters. So take the proton. Well, the proton, you know, are quarks and gluons rattling around inside some region of space defined by, well, where the coupling gets strong. You try to pull them apart, that at a roughly the radius of the proton, you can't because the force is too strong. That defines a length where the force is strong enough to confine the quarks and the gluons. And if the quarks were massless, the energy in that volume was just the kinetic energy of the massless quarks and gluons. And so the mass defines a length, defines the strength of the coupling, and all mass ratios, dimensionless quantities, you need some scale, that's the mass, say, of the proton, are calculable. And the strong interaction, this alpha S, is calculable. So in QCD, if you put the quark mass is equal to zero, every physical object is calculable. There are no adjustable parameters, except, of course, the number of colors and the number of quarks. And in the real world, the number of the quark masses and gravity and the other forces of nature. Finally, the remarkable thing about QCD and at that time in physics especially was that it said, there's, you know, as far as strong interaction goes, there's no new physics at short distances. No, nothing bad or new happens at high energies. To the contrary, at high energies, theory becomes simpler. You can use perturbation theory better and better. This had a lot of implications. Most important one, perhaps, was that the early universe should be very simple. Furthermore, one could imagine unifying the forces, and then there's another benefit of Dirac's large number problem. So at that time, people, you know, had discovered 10 years before or less, the CMB, cosmology had been transformed into the Big Bang theory, if you want, right? We knew the universe expanded from a very dense state, hot state, and we could see back to almost the beginning using cosmic microwave background. And cosmologists, astroparticle physicists started thinking about, you know, go back further and we can see what was the universe like when it was very hot and very dense. But if you just thought about that as nuclear physics and unknown quantum physics, it was a hadron hell. But with QCD, it became a quark soup. You could go back and, you know, start exploring what happens when hadrons, quarks, and gluons are heated or made very dense. And you could do that studying perturbation theory because the theory becomes simple and easily show that you expect there to be a phase transition. Very high temperatures, protons will melt, gluons and quarks will escape, and there will be some kind of arbitrarily high energies, a quark-gluon plasma, which we can actually explore in the lab, but also in the early universe. And that's a whole another subject, an enormous subject of the behavior of quarks and gluons, hadrons, at very high temperatures, very high energies. And you'd expect, you know, asymptotic mediums would tell you at very high energies, there's no force at all. So you can't have confinement somehow. Very high energies should have free quarks and gluons. Same thing with density, which introduces a net baryon number. Can be affect neutron stars at their core, perhaps, and certainly observable at heavy ion colliders, like initially Rick and Alice now and to come. And finally, you could extrapolate strong interactions to very high energies and see, you know, whether they become as already suggested by the big standard model, unified with the weak and electromagnetic interactions. And this extrapolation, which happened 48 years ago, remarkably discovered that that these forces become equal in strength at an extremely high energies, not that far from where gravity becomes an important quantum force. And that, of course, has dominated speculative particle physics, certainly for me and my friends, but for most of the community for the last 40 years. Try to understand what, how this unification takes place, and especially perhaps with gravity, string theory being the by far the most interesting idea that has emerged. Okay, and finally, athletic freedom kind of solves a problem noticed by Dirac back in 1937 that physics, in a fundamental sense, is plagued with very large numbers, like the ratio of the proton mass to the Planck mass defined by Newton's constants, the scale there. So this fact of nature, this 10 to the minus 19, is so crucial for us because it, you know, it explains that have to be a large number, roughly the cube of the inverse of this number protons inside a star before it collapses to a black hole. So the fact that this number is so small is why gravity is so weak at low energies, is why big objects like planets or humans can exist without collapsing to black holes. But where does this number come from, and how could you possibly calculate it? And Dirac noticed a few such large numbers, all tending to be multiples, products of 10 to the minus 20 or things like that. For example, the size of the universe, the observable universe, compared to the size of the atom. Now, Dirac could have tried to argue anthropically, right? He could have said, well, you know, if the proton mass was much bigger than 10 to the minus 19, the Planck mass, then a star couldn't have more than 1,000 atoms before it became a black hole, and we wouldn't exist. So we're not in that portion of the multiverse. But Dirac was a sensible physicist, so he didn't go that way. And he had no idea how to calculate such a number, but he tried to relate these different large numbers. Some of them were time dependent. So he suggested, okay, we can test this kind of, test an idea that they're all related somehow. And therefore, the fundamental parameters that define the Planck mass or the strength of the coupling should vary with time. And that can be tested because we have things like nuclear reactors, you know, natural deposits of uranium that have been functioning as nuclear reactors for billions of years. So you could try to measure time variation of these numbers. And so far, there's no evidence that these are varying over cosmological times. But we can now roughly calculate this ratio, QCD. Not all these large numbers, but this one, yes. And it's because the, you know, one imagines that at very high energies where the forces unify with gravity, the coupling is of, you know, order weaker than alpha at MZ, continues to decrease, but only logarithmically. So maybe it's of the order of the fine structure constant, maybe slightly bigger. And then you can calculate the mass of the proton because you go to lower and lower energies, the force gets stronger at increasing distances. At some distance scale, it becomes strong enough to confine the quarks. That defines the radius of the proton, that scale, the mass of the proton, and you can calculate just as we illustrated before. And if you put in the numbers according to, you know, extrapolating what we know about the standard model, a Planck mass, you get roughly 10 to the minus 19, maybe 10 to the minus 16, maybe 10 to the minus 22. But anyway, roughly this largeness is part of the solution of the large number problem. Of course, there are many other issues in the real world, like the mass of the Higgs, don't understand why it's so small compared to the black matter. Okay, so QCD is the first example of a complete theory with no adjustable parameters, no indication within the theory of a distance scale where it must break down, infinite bandwidth. But of course, there's the rest of the world. We don't understand the number of colors, the quark masses and mixings, and of course there are other forces like electroweak and gravity. My opinion, the most important development over the last 50 years in QCD and our understanding of non-abelian gauge theories, which are the basis of the standard model, is the connection with string theory. Now that began before QCD. People phenomenologically constructed mathematical models of the strong interactions, the dual resonance model that led to string theory, because the mesons do look like fat strings. But it is clearly, in my opinion, one of the most profound thing we've learned is that gauge theories, non-abelian gauge theories, and string theories are really different aspects of the same underlying fundamental concept of nature. Early on, it was realized there aren't just these mesons. If you have open strings, you can close them. And it was discovered that those look like gravitons. So not only can you describe strong and electroweak and electromagnetic interactions using string theory, but also gravity. That has really given rise to a hope for getting analytic control of QCD in the infrared. Because we know that as number of colors becomes big, QCD is described by some kind of non-interacting theory, some kind of classical theory with an infinite number of glue balls that are confined, a theory, an effective theory where when the number of, one over the number of colors is the classical limit. And this is probably a string theory. A lot of evidence for this, planar diagram structure of large N matrix theory, the fact that many aspects of QCD can be understood in a large N expansion, and most importantly, the ADS-C-CFT duality, in which string theory, open strings ending on brains, are dual to closed strings. And certain setups, a complete theory of gauge interactions in gravity can be described either by quantum theory on the boundary of anti-de Sitter space. And this is true for supersymmetric gauge theories in four dimensions, close cousins of QCD, or by strings in this ADS bulk. And the hope is that, at least large N number of supersymmetric charges, so highly supersymmetric quantum chromodynamics could be solved exactly. It's a scale invariant theory. It doesn't produce a mass gap or a photon, but it's a lot simpler. When the number of colors becomes very big, it's integrable. Easy to solve, sort of, and can be deformed, in principle to real QCD. Make the masses of some of the extra part states you require to achieve supersymmetry arbitrarily big. Include quarks and their interactions, and maybe at least get analytic control over the theory for a large number of colors, and then do a one over number of color expansion. So what do I expect in the future? Well, perturbatively, there's going to be continuing discoveries of the incredibly rich and suggestive in many directions behavior of perturbative non-abelian gauge theory of QCD and its partners. Numerically, lattice gauge theory is this incredible tool, but now massive efforts are being beginning to explore lattice gauge theory for time-dependent phenomena, using Hamiltonian truncation and eventually quantum computers. And then one can begin to study numerically or solve the theory numerically in the Lorentzian regime and calculate some of the ingredients that go into calculating LHC backgrounds and, you know, how do quarks turn into hadrons? How do they break up and so on? And going back to Reggie behavior, diffraction scattering. But most interesting, there are going to be a lot of new experiments and experimental probes. There's, of course, LHC, which is now starting up with increased luminosity. And there, LHCb and Atlas and CMS as well have discovered lots of new work bound states, which are seem to be described not three quarks in a proton, but four pentaquarks, tetraquarks, fascinating. Roughly 50 new particles have been discovered at the LHC. Alice is continuing to probe the quark gluon plasma, where a phase transition to deconfined quarks and gluons takes place. Fascinating. And important, perhaps, for astroparticle physical contributions to astrophysics and cosmology. And even elastic scattering, which started the whole thing, is now going to have a major development with the electron ion collider, which is going to be built at Brookhaven, and collide electrons off ions. And that will enable, well, even elastic scattering to be probed with incredibly increased precision and large momentum transfer, or actually more diffraction scattering, and as well as nucleons, the structure of nuclear physics, which nuclear physics is really quark gluon physics, and is turning now from a rather phenomenological theory of particle exchange based on, you know, to quark and gluon physics. And that's very exciting. So let me just end by, you know, Feynman was once asked, or once said, if in some cataclysm all of scientific knowledge were to be destroyed and only one sentence passed on to the next generation of creatures, perhaps silicon creatures, who knows, what statement would contain the most information in the fewest words? So he tried to summarize this message in one sentence. It's almost impossible. But he said, I believe it's the atomic hypothesis or the atomic fact or whatever you want to call it. That one sentence. All things are made of atoms, little particles that move around in perpetual motion, attracting each other when they're a little distance apart, but repelling upon being squeezed into one another. Now, you think about it, that's one sentence of which really summarizes, you know, our standard theory of ordinary matter. So I tried to do the same for the standard model. Impossible in one sentence, but this is sort of one slide. Standard model, what have we learned? Matter is made out of charged spin 1/2 fermions with forces described by quantum non-abelian gauge theory, which exists in three phases, electromagnetism, or U1, in a long-range forces, Coulomb phase, weak interactions generated by SU2 gauge theory, which is screened, or Higgs, by a somewhat unnatural scalar field sector, and finally QCD, the strong interactions SU3 gauge field, which exists in the confined phase. This is not one sentence again, but what we've learned on one slide from QCD. Well, the most important thing, of course, is that it is undeniably the theory of the strong nuclear force. But it's the first theory where the dynamics can determine all masses and all couplings. And finally, the most important thing, eventually, I believe, is the gate string duality. So the hero, indeed, in the last 50 years of particle physics has been non-abelian gauge theory, which provides a basis for QCD, and it's solved its mysteries, as well as the whole standard model, electroweak, electromagnetism, and QCD. But the real secret of all of this is connected, I believe, in a deeper level, which we have yet to understand fully, with string theory, and which remarkably will connect the standard model to quantum gravity, as well as what space-time really is and how it emerges. And with that, I come to the end of this talk, but not the end of QCD. Thank you.
Thank you for taking us to this beautiful journey of QCD and the strong interactions. So I will collect the question from the audience. Yes.
Hi. Thank you for the very nice talk. I was wondering, since you and Atish both mentioned it was studies of QCD and its close cousins that eventually led to the stunning development of the ADS safety correspondence. I was wondering about your perspectives on the other way of the symbiosis, namely what some close analog of the ADS safety or holographic correspondence can teach us about QCD in the real world as we know it, with n equals 3, which is non-supersymmetric and non-conformal, maybe you know, in the context of some noticeable efforts such as those by Witten, Sakai, Sugimoto, and others.
I'm not sure I totally got your question, but yeah. So ADS-CFT has been a remarkable development, which enables us to probe the string, gauge string duality. But it's a duality between string theory, which doesn't really have, except through the duality, a definition, non-perturbative definition, and gauge theories, which do. Gauge theories we understand for weak coupling, you know, and that works beautifully in asymptotically free theories in some domain. We want to understand the strong coupling. Gate quantum gravity or string theory we understand very well classically, but we want to understand, and in flat or, you know, almost flat space. But we want to understand it in highly curved spaces and for strong coupling. So those are the difficult aspects of the. It's just beginning to be some understanding of one of the most interesting corners, which is the weak coupling limit of non-abelian gauge theory. Asymptotically free regime where you start with free field theory and quantum gravity or string theory. So that correspondence on the string theory side requires an extremely highly curved space, not a very almost flat space. So it requires an ADS dual with a very small radius compared to the string length. So that, we have very little understanding on the string side, very good understanding on the perturbative QCD side. And there have been recent developments of trying to truly understand the string theory side and, you know, see if the duality, how the duality holds and what is the best way of understanding and being able to calculate on that string side. So from the point of view of QCD, the main guidance there is what does that effective string theory that describes QCD effects look like? Okay. We can only really probe that using ADS-EFT in the supersymmetric theory, but that should give us some hint. One can also probe that effective string theory for QCD using lattice gauge theory, using just general ideas for, and you know, that is one area where some recent progress has come about. Lots of interesting hints, and I think it's a very, very exciting area. And one could imagine one understands that the effective string theory that describes mesons are really making some rapid and important progress. Then there's the other side, what we learn about quantum gravity in situations where the classical limit is not good. And that is proceeding as well. So, you know, this tool is extremely powerful, but so far it's been mostly employed to test and confirm and slightly extrapolate new old physics that one knew about before. But if it really, you know, is a complete duality, one is going to, in the future, be able to use it and other ideas to fill out our understanding of, say, gauge theory for strong coupling. That's we need to really understand nuclear physics, if you want, as well as quantum gravity for highly curved places and strong coupling. So it's a very exciting time, at least for theorists. It would be even greater if one could get some important experimental clues.
Thank you.
In cold, dense matter, if we can avoid gravitational collapse, is deconfinement inevitable at some critical density?
Yeah, sure. Yes, and it's roughly calculable, and it's roughly, of course, the mass scale of QCD, a few hundred MeV. But, depends what you mean by really. If you're asking for rigor, okay, that's that's a different standard than we usually employ. Maybe there'll be a rigorous, so, you know, there's a Clay Millennium Prize for $1 million if you can prove that QCD makes sense and produces a mass scale. I talked about dimensional transmutation. That's the essence of an asymptotically free theory. And if that, you can rigorously prove that you get $1 million. That's proving confinement, if you want. That hasn't been proved, but it's surely true. So, and there's direct, you know, lattice gauge theory can be used to probe the high temperature behavior. It's much harder the high density. But the high temperature behavior of QCD, there's no question there's a deconfining phase transition. You can use the non-rigorous techniques of physics to show that, okay, you're arbitrarily weak coupling. You can use perturbation theory to show there's confinement. And then there's an experiment. So at REC, we've been scattering ions on ions, produce a fireball with an effective temperature for short times, inside, which is above the deconfining transition. And the properties, you know, what comes out depends on the phase of that state. And what there was a bit of surprise, I must say, because we sort of expected naively at the beginning that there would be, you get above the deconfinement phase transition, then free quarks and gluons. Not totally free, the non-abelian plasma, very complicated, but a plasma-like state. Instead, what was discovered that there was deconfinement, all right, but more like a kind of strongly interacting liquid phase, which is very interesting. And actually, ADS-EFT duality, which relates those fireballs to black holes, has been very useful in studying the behavior of that fluid. As we get to higher and higher energies, then it will be very interesting, this electron-ion collider that's turning on, we'll learn more about that phase. But eventually, no, there should be a deconfined, weakly interacting quarks and gluons. It's not a simple plasma because non-abelian, the vector, but it's not like electromagnetic plasma where the photons are neutral. Here the gluons are charged, so it's much more complicated and interesting. But I can't prove any of this.
Thank you. Any more questions? Maybe I have one. So where do you expect the next revolution in QCD? Maybe from the gravity side, like you mentioned, or maybe quantum computers for solving the strongly coupled theory?
I think all of it. You know, there needs to be many, many new developments. So, actually, I am now part of a new collaboration that's been set up, you know, one of these Simon Foundation collaborations at QCD, which is trying to bring together a lot of different kinds of people to attack some of these problems in a fresh way. And to attract some of the younger people, perhaps in this audience, who think that physics began with ADS-EFT, to these host of fantastic issues, which can be now and in the future even better tested experimentally. And that this collaboration brings together people doing holography, if you want, people doing you know, really mathematical physics, in gauge theories and supersymmetric gauge theories, people doing lattice gauge theory, people doing anything. There are many different ways of approaching this problem, and they all are connected and can give insight. The physical phenomena that remain to be understood are going to be around forever. We still are studying, you know, 150 years later after Maxwell, electromagnetism and discovering new phenomena and deeper understanding, and by the standards of non-abelian gauge theory or string theory, electromagnetism is a pretty trivial theory. So, you know, this is going to go on for centuries, but if you're looking for new ideas and don't want to necessarily work in a field where everyone else is working, not a bad, and you might have some new ideas and new insight, not a bad field to move into at this point in time. A lot of new possibilities.
Thank you. All right, so if there are no more questions, I will thank Professor Gross again. Thank you very much. And for all of us, there will be a coffee break attending us in the terrace. Thank you.